Can you hear me? About 10 years ago or so, I locked myself away in a house on the ocean, and I tried to, I said I was trying to write music, some of which wound up on Fragile, but what I was really doing was trying to kill myself. And the whole time I was away by myself, I managed to write one song, which is this song. So when I play it, I feel pretty weird about it.
This is a video I've been wanting to make for almost a year now. And it was actually, the original idea for it was inspired by kind of my emotions at the time when Chester Bennington of Linkin Park passed. Alongside Linkin Park, Nine Inch Nails has always been one of my all-time favorite artists. At the core of their music, there's something very emotionally similar about the way Chester and Mike would write lyrics and the way that the two of them would express themselves on stage. I also see a bit of a parallel between Chester Bennington and Trent Reznor and the way that they present themselves on stage. They both have a very authentic level of anger, kind of pent-up frustration, that's usually unleashed on stage in a very extreme way, usually in forms of scream singing or belting as hard as you can. There was a really nice video a few weeks back of Mike Shinoda at a recent concert he did, a solo concert he did. And at one point, he mentioned to the crowd,
"It of course would not be right if we did not acknowledge our friend."
Wow. "Oh my God, don't do it!
Justin! Who we love very much, who is looking down on us right now, who wants each and every one of you to be okay.
Yeah! We will, man, we will.
And in the spirit of that, people used to ask me, back when we put out our first album, they said, oh, your album was so angry, your album was so angsty, blah, blah, blah. And what all of us knew that they didn't know was that it wasn't about the negativity, it was about getting the negativity out and coming to a show and being positive. And letting all that bad stuff come out so that it didn't come out in other places in a negative way, are we right?"
Ultimately, negative sounding music is an attempt to express and relay and ultimately overcome extremely powerful negative emotions. Myself, as someone who has been battling depression and anxiety for now the majority of my life, I've always found that really loud, angry music like Nine Inch Nails and Linkin Park, by listening to their songs, I can very effectively drown out all the really negative, angry noise in my head, and a lot of the times also expel that negative energy through singing and belting really loudly, the same way those guys do. But today I'd like to talk about Nine Inch Nails, and I'll do a separate video on Linkin Park sometime in the future. I think most people have that certain artist that they listen to more than others when they're feeling bad or angry, and they really need to change that. And for me, that band has always been Nine Inch Nails. Now, I have a piano here in front of me today, but it's mostly just for show. And what I'd actually like to start off by doing is showing a piano sheet music track from YouTube that I found. One of my all-time favorite Nine Inch Nails songs, The Frail. So let's just get into it. First off, I'm gonna play the original track. So this is just a minute and a half instrumental. It's more of a transitional piece from one track to another and serves as a very smooth necessary transition into the next song. Now, you'd probably describe this track as wandering. It sounds a bit lost. We have two things happening on the piano here. In the bottom hand, we have this slowly ascending four-note progression that consistently ascends at this rate throughout the entire song. This part of the song does not change the whole time. But initially, it just kind of serves as this foundation for the song. The first time you listen to it, if you haven't heard this song, you're probably going to pay attention to the part being played in the right hand, which in itself is a lot more light and maybe feels a bit more polite. But it also provides the sense of wandering in the song, because as you can see, while these foundation bass notes that kind of comprise the essence of the song, basically the bass guitar of the song, if this was a bass and a guitar. Meanwhile, the upper hand is doing this wandering, speculative, it feels like there's a lot of intention behind it. At least for me, it kind of gives the impression of feeling lost. Looking around, not sure where to go next, not sure what to do. It's kind of a calm sense of confusion or frustration. And then right here, as you may have noticed, at the 1 minute mark, we have this very eerie, grainy, airy kind of synth coming in, and it starts to feel a little bit ominous. Now, as you can notice, the upper part of the song, the very nice and polite and light part of it that kind of makes you feel comfortable, is gone. It's been swallowed up by this very eerie synth, and the only thing we hear is the bass notes steadily, slowly creeping upwards as if something is approaching you from behind. At this point, you may also start to notice, now that the piano part has fallen out and we're just left with the synth, there's also a very, very light, very hard to pick out, but it's there. It sounds like Trent Reznor's vocals, kind of holding a... Try to listen for that. Now, to be honest, I'm not sure if that's vocals or a synth part, but either way, it sounds like a voice kind of pained and calling out, but at a volume quieter than is necessary for someone to hear it. The song has now transformed from what was initially a very kind of polite, mildly eerie, I would say even soothing piano instrumental that has turned into something dark and foreboding and uncomfortable. And this brings us to the second of two songs that I want to talk about today. We have to talk about the absolute best part of the song, which is the transition between these two tracks here. So I'm gonna let this play, but keep in mind that what we heard with The Frail first was something foreboding, that something is coming, and it feels like it's kind of creeping up on you. Now we've made it to The Wretched. That bassline piano part that was at once providing a foundation for the song, a kind of very solid, protective foundation. Now that foundation is turned on us, but it's more controlled. It's more mastered. and it's certainly a lot more negative. Not only that, but we have this very percussive synthy track that kind of rattles in your ears if you're listening with headphones. Now the vocals have come in. They're a bit shouty, they're aggressive. There's an underlying layer of kind of this growling angst that I really love, that Trent Reznor masters so well. This is a perfect example of one of the things that makes Trent Reznor and Chester Bennington two of my absolute all-time favorite vocalists. So they were never afraid to create sounds with their vocals that were directly ripped out from these deeply negative emotions. I'm gonna play it one more time. Alright, so I already have so much to talk about again. First off, the most noticeable thing you probably heard there was that really discomforting, high-pitched, squealing synth sound. It's probably a sample that Trent Reznor created or found somewhere. For me, I kind of get the image of glass being shattered. When you think about the action of shattering glass, it's the noise it creates, it's high pitch, it echoes. All of the pieces crumbling to the ground and scattering about. The action of breaking glass, I think, is a very negative one, especially put into the context of being in a fit of passion where you're extremely angry and maybe you put your fist through glass. That's what this sound reminds me of, that high-pitched squealing. It's like putting your fist through glass and getting your arm all chopped up and bloody. You may say, wow, that's really terrible. That sounds really horrible and awful. I don't like to think about that. And that's totally valid. For me and many others, I think that this kind of relay of very negative actions tied to very negative emotions serves as a very effective release. The fact that you're listening to a song and you're singing, you're doing something fun, and you're doing something proactive, and you're doing something that helps you feel good while still listening to something that would be considered negative. So just looking at the lyrics here that we just heard, just a reflection, just a glimpse, just a little reminder of all the whatabouts and all that might have been, could have been, another day, some other way. So right there, you have this imagery of a person beside himself, a person who can barely remember himself, a glimpse. He has a reflection of himself, a tiny little reminder of all the whatabouts, all that might have been. This is such an effective way of translating what it feels to really be lost and so deeply upset, is that all of these lines are all about this one idea of my former self, or being beside myself, and that I am a different version of myself now. And given the context of everything we've talked about so far, obviously this new version of the self is not in a good place by any means. And all of this idea of the self leads up to this line, but not another reason to continue. The one thing in all of his desperate searching he couldn't find was a reason to continue. And given the context of the opening clip I showed with Trent Reznor at a concert talking about the song La Mer, this is in reference to having suicidal thoughts. The hopes and prayers, the better days, the faraways, forget it. Three very positive, happy, hopeful ideas and images being put in your head. The typical rules of rock music is that you want every line to rhyme. Hopes and praise, the better days, the faraways. They flow really well. They follow a cadence. They follow a projection that is typical and standard for a positive rock song. The part that makes it so perfectly Nine Inch Nails is that he drops the rhymes, he drops the pattern of the rhythm, he drops everything that has been established musically and says, forget it. Now moving on to the pre-chorus and the chorus. I'm going to read these lyrics. Obviously, it's simply just a continuation of what we've already had. It didn't turn out the way you wanted it to. It didn't turn out the way you wanted it to, did it? It didn't turn out the way you wanted it to. It didn't turn out the way you wanted it to, did it? He has such a way of choosing words that really make you feel pretty terrible. It isn't just it didn't turn out the way you wanted it to. It's also a call and response, with the response having a mocking tone at the end of it. Someone mocking you when you've already hit your lowest point. That is the type of thing that causes people to break. And that break in emotion, that explosion of angry emotion, is perfectly exemplified here when we go into the chorus of, now you know, this is what it feels like. Now you know, this is what it feels like. I'm just gonna do a little bit more of this song because I do want to point out one of my absolute favorite parts of any Nine Inch Nails song. Clouds will part and the sky cracks open and God himself will reach his fucking arm through just to push you down. But let's listen to the way that Trent Reznor sings these lyrics. If I'm ever in a car and this song comes on, this is the part that I look forward to singing the most. Pretty powerful stuff. All right, and with that, I'm gonna move on to the last song I wanted to talk about today. For a long time, I have considered this to be my favorite Nine Inch Nails song. It's a song that no matter when I listen to it, no matter when it's on, no matter what context I hear it in, it's something that makes me really think and feel things, but in an emotional state that's a lot different than the last few songs you heard. So let's check it out. Right away, very similar to The Frail, but whereas The Frail had a bit more dissonance and a bit more of a minor kind of wandering tone, this feels more confident. It's still somber, but it's not desperate, it's concentrated, it's sure of itself, and for me, it's very comforting. As I understand it, Trent Reznor wrote this song, the original version, which is very loud and very in your face, as a response to his grandmother passing away. He was so wrought with emotional turmoil that he wrote a song about it, and it's actually one of the songs on the album, The Fragile, the original version. And then a few years later, he released this version, which is a lot quieter, a lot more stripped down, a lot simpler. And it's obviously softer. And you get a very different emotional response from it, because the original track is very similar to the song we just heard, The Wretched. It's loud, it's frightening, it's in your face. It's really meant to feel like the end of the world is upon you in that moment. Whereas this one feels like it's someone writing the same song, but from the perspective of having learned and having recovered and having become a stronger person and having accepted the fact that grieving and pain and suffering are a normal part of life. And there's this very warm, beautiful comfort I feel right here that's all at once deeply saddening. But at the same time, it's telling you, I know you're sad right now, but believe it or not, everything's gonna be okay if you just hold on.
About 10 years ago or so, I locked myself away in a house on the ocean. And I tried to, I said I was trying to write music, some of which wound up on Fragile. But what I was really doing was trying to kill myself. And the whole time I was away by myself, I managed to write one song, which is this song. So when I play it, I feel pretty weird about it, because it takes me back to a pretty dark and awful time in my life. It's weird to think how different things are now. I'm still alive. I haven't died yet. I'm afraid to go back to that place because it feels kind of haunted to me, but I'm gonna go back. I'm gonna get married there.